lecture we are going to discuss about the next type of detector, which is the Geiger-Müller counter and also termed as GM counter. So this Geiger-Müller counter is one of the oldest radiation detector types in existence, and this counter was introduced by Geiger and Müller in 1928. And because of the simplicity, its low cost of manufacture and ease of operation, this counter is still used till date. So this counter is used to detect alpha particles, beta particles, gamma radiations, and with certain modifications we can also use this counter for the detection of neutron radiations. Now we are going to look at the construction of GM counter. So GM counter consists of a Geiger-Müller tube. So this is the very important part of the GM counter. So there is a Geiger-Müller tube and some electronics is attached with this GM tube, which helps us to display the result. So there is a GM tube and there is some electronics, some amplifiers and counters which are attached to this GM tube, which helps us to display results. So this GM tube is filled with some inert gas like argon, neon or helium. So this is the GM tube. And this tube is filled with a certain inert gas like argon or neon or helium, etc. And in the next lecture, we will discuss that in addition to this inert gas, we have a quench gas. So along with this inert gas, we also have a quench gas, and its working will be discussed in the next lecture. Now, what is this GM tube? So the GM tube consists of a cylindrical metallic envelope. So there is a cylindrical metallic envelope. Now this metallic envelope consists of a glass envelope in the form of a cylinder, and the inner side of the glass envelope is coated with a certain metal of high work function. So this is a glass envelope and its inner side is coated with a certain metal, and that layer, that coating acts as cathode. So that coating is connected to the negative terminal of the external voltage, so it will act as the cathode. Then we have the central wire, this wire which is made up of tungsten. So this lies on the axis of the cylinder, and through some external resistor this wire is attached, is connected to the positive terminal of the external voltage. Now, as we know, in the case of GM counter, this external voltage is very high. So it ranges between 750 to 1000 volts or even greater. So this external voltage in the case of GM tube is extremely high. Therefore, the end of this anode wire, the end of this anode wire is covered by a glass bead. So this acts as the insulator, and this glass bead avoids corona discharge because this wire, this central wire, is connected to a extremely high voltage, due to which a discharge can happen at the end of this wire. So to avoid the discharge, we cover the end of this wire with the glass bead. Then we have a thin mica window over here. So the working of this window is that it allows the incoming particles, ionizing particles, to enter the GM tube. So we have a thin window is provided at one end of the chamber through which the ionizing particle enters the GM tube. And a cylindrical metal coating inside a glass envelope is used. So a cylindrical metal coating is done inside a glass envelope in place of a metallic cylinder. So we do not have a metallic cylinder, but we have certain glass envelope, and its inside surface is coated with the certain metal like stainless steel or nickel or any material with large value of work function. So why do we take large value of work function? Its reason will be discussed in the upcoming lectures. Now, what is the principle on which the GM counter works? So the GM counter works on the principle of Geiger discharge. So this is very important term, Geiger discharge. Now, what is this Geiger discharge? When an ionizing particle enters a GM tube, any ionizing particle like alpha particle, beta particle, so any ionizing particle enters a GM tube, it ionizes the gas molecules. As we have said that inside the GM tube we have a certain inert gas. So the ionizing particle ionizes the gas molecules. So during this ionization we get electrons, and these electrons get accelerated under the high potential which we have applied. So this we have already discussed in the case of proportional counters. So electrons which are formed in the primary ionization get accelerated under the high potential which leads to Townsend avalanche. So this is similar to the proportional counter. But what is the difference of a GM counter, a GM tube from a proportional counter? So in the case of proportional counter, we also had Townsend avalanche, and in this case also we will get a Townsend avalanche. But in this GM tube, in the case of GM tube, one avalanche can itself trigger a second avalanche. So in the case of proportional counter, let's say one ion pair, one electron which gets accelerated towards the anode wire, it makes one Townsend avalanche. So when the electron moves towards the anode wire, it will cause further secondary ionizations and a Townsend avalanche is obtained. A cascade of electrons reach the anode wire. So this thing happens in the case of GM tube also, but in this case one avalanche which is formed can trigger another avalanche at a different position within the tube. So one avalanche formed can trigger the second avalanche at a different position in the same tube. And a self-propagating chain reaction occurs, means one avalanche can trigger another avalanche, and this second avalanche can trigger third avalanche, and so on. So this is a self-propagating chain reaction occurs inside the GM tube, and this is called as Giger discharge. So this self-propagating chain reaction means one avalanche leading to another avalanche, and this second avalanche leading to a third avalanche, and so on. This phenomena, this process gives us a large height of pulse. So due to this process, large height of pulse is obtained in the case of GM tube, and this process is called as Giger discharge. So the GM tube works on this Giger discharge. So now we are going to look at Giger discharge in more detail. Now in a typical Townsend avalanche created by a single original electron, let's say when some ionizing radiation enters the GM tube, and let's say at this point ionization occurs. The gas molecule gets ionized into a positive ion, some positive ion is formed, and electron is formed. So a free electron is formed in the case of primary ionization. So in a typical Townsend avalanche, what happens is that this electron, when it is drifting towards the anode wire, because this is at positive potential and cathode is at negative potential, so this electron will drift towards the anode wire, and due to its cylindrical geometry, the electric field strength increases as you are moving towards the center. So as you are moving towards the anode wire, which is kept at the center, the strength of the electric field increases, due to which the acceleration of this electron increases as it is drifting towards the central wire. So if its acceleration is increasing, means its velocity is increasing. If its velocity is increasing, means it is gaining kinetic energy. The kinetic energy of this electron is increasing as it is drifting towards the anode wire. So there will be a tendency that this electron will make further ionizations, which are called as secondary ionizations. So that we call as Townsend avalanche. So one electron will lead to the formation of second electron, and the first electron will remain as it is. So the first electron which was formed in the primary ionization process, this first electron is drifting towards the anode wire, and during its journey it ionized another gas molecule. So now we have two electrons. So one electron is the same which was formed in the primary ionization, and the second electron is the one which is formed in the secondary ionization. Now these two electrons will be drifting towards the anode wire, and as they are drifting towards the anode wire, they will further make secondary ionizations. So this electron will again ionize another gas molecule. So in turn we will have two electrons over here, and similarly this electron will lead to another secondary ionization. So now we will have two electrons which are drifting towards the anode wire, and similarly this process will continue like this. So we will have plenty of electrons, a cascade of electrons you can see are reaching the central anode wire and so on. So this is called as Townsend avalanche. In a typical Townsend avalanche created by a single original electron, so you can see that this avalanche is created by a single electron at the first place. Many excited gas molecules are formed. Now in this Townsend avalanche, so this Townsend avalanche occurs in the case of proportional counter. Now in the case of GM counter, again this Townsend avalanche happens, but in this case many excited gas molecules are formed. So in the case of GM tube, in the case of GM counter, when secondary ionizations are made, in addition to the secondary ionizations, some of the gas molecules get excited. So some of the gas molecules will get ionized, but some of the gas molecules will get excited, and when these gas molecules will de-excite to their ground state, in that process they will emit photons. But this thing doesn't happen in the case of proportional counter, because as we have said, in the case of proportional counter we use methane gas which is used to absorb these photons. So methane gas limits the gas multiplication, as we have already discussed in the previous lecture. But in the case of GM tube, these photons are emitted because in this Townsend avalanche many excited gas molecules are formed by the electron collisions in addition to the secondary ions. So secondary ionizations are also occurring, but in addition to that some of the gas molecules get excited, and when they de-excite, when they return to their ground state after a few nanoseconds, when they return to their ground state, they emit radiations through emission of photons. So these excited gas molecules return to their ground state through the emission of photons, and these photons are generally in the visible or UV region. So you can see that, you can say that some visible photon or UV photon is emitted in this process. So here I have shown only one UV photon, but there can be large number of UV photons or visible photons emitted in one Townsend avalanche. Now what happens after this? This UV photon, as it is traveling in the GM tube, it can cause another ionization at some another position in the same GM tube. So this UV photon or the visible photon, as it is traveling in the GM tube, at some other location it can cause ionization of the gas molecule. So this photon may be absorbed elsewhere in the gas. So this photon may be absorbed elsewhere in the gas and could release a less tightly bound electron. So when this UV photon encounters some gas molecule, any gas molecule, this photon can ionize that gas molecule. So in that process one electron will be formed and positive ion will be formed. So this electron will drift towards the anode, the central wire. So as it will drift towards the anode wire, it will cause secondary ionizations like this. So one electron is moving towards anode wire. During its journey, it can ionize another gas molecule, and hence you will have two electrons traveling towards the central wire. And again, these electrons can cause further secondary ionizations as they are moving towards the anode wire. And similarly, you will get cascade of electrons which are reaching the anode wire. So you can see that we had, at first place, we had one Townsend avalanche, and in this Townsend avalanche a UV photon is emitted, and this UV photon can go to another location in the GM tube and it can trigger another avalanche. So this is the meaning of this statement, that one avalanche can itself trigger a second avalanche. So you can see one Townsend avalanche has triggered another avalanche. Now the same process can happen. Some UV photon would be emitted in this Townsend avalanche. Let's say from this position a UV photon is emitted, and this UV photon will cause the ionization of another gas molecule at some other position in the GM tube. So this electron will drift towards the central wire, and in that process it will cause secondary ionizations like this. So this process will happen continuously. So let's say at some other position, let's say from here a UV photon is emitted, and this photon will cause ionization of the gas molecule at some other position. So this electron will drift towards the anode wire and it will form another Townsend avalanche like this. So the newly created free electrons will migrate towards the anode. These newly created, this is the newly created free electron, this is the newly created free electron, and this is the newly created free electron by the UV photon or the visible photon. So these will migrate towards the anode. So when they will migrate towards the anode wire, as they are drifting towards the anode wire in this direction, they will trigger another avalanche. So this is what we mean by giga discharge. Now another thing can also happen over here, that this UV photon which is emitted, let's say from here if a UV photon is emitted, this photon, it can cause the emission of electron from the cathode. So this cathode is made up of some conductor. So when this UV photon will reach the cathode, it can release a free electron from this cathode itself. So it will be absorbed by a certain free electron which is present in the cathode. So that electron will come into the chamber, and this electron when will drift towards the anode wire, again it will lead to another Townsend avalanche. So in this manner, you will have cascade of electrons which are reaching the anode wire. So this photon may be absorbed elsewhere in the gas. So this photon would be absorbed elsewhere in the gas and could release a less tightly bound electron, or this photon may reach the cathode wall, or this photon may reach the cathode wall and release a free electron upon absorption. So a free electron would be released, and this free electron which is released will further produce another avalanche. So you can see that due to these photons, the giga discharge grows. So due to the emission of this photon, another avalanche is formed. Then due to the emission of another UV photon, another avalanche is formed. So the giga discharge grows due to these photons. And you can see that these avalanche, they cover the whole anode wire. So over here I have shown only 5 avalanches I have shown. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Only 5 avalanches I have shown on this diagram. But in actual, there would be large number of Townsend avalanche formed across the anode wire. Means the giga discharge grows due to the emission of these photons, and these avalanche, they cover the entire anode wire. So they will cover this entire anode wire. And No matter how many number of electron ion pairs are formed in the primary ionization, the pulse height will remain the same. So you can see that over here I have said that primary ionization is made at this point. So ionizing radiation, any alpha particle or beta particle, let's say it forms one ion pair. So you can see that due to the formation of one ion pair, large number of electrons are reaching the anode wire. Now let's say if two ion pairs are formed at the initial stage. So let's say if another ion pair by the alpha particle is formed at this point, so another primary ionization is done at this point, so this electron will form further Townsend avalanche. So the difference will be negligible. The difference of the number of electrons collected at the anode will be negligible, because in the case of one ion pair, you can see that almost whole of the gas around this anode wire will get ionized. So almost whole of the gas around the anode wire, in the vicinity of this anode wire, will get ionized. And similar thing happen when you will have two ion pairs at the initial stage. So this diagram I have drawn only for the case of one ion pair formed in the primary ionization. So you will see that when you have two ion pairs at the initial stage, in that case also the same number of, almost same number of electrons will be reaching the anode wire. So regardless of the position or the number of primary ionizations made, the pulse height will remain the same. So the number of electrons getting collected at the anode wire will remain almost the same, due to which pulse height in the case of GM tube remains the same. So the Giger discharge grows and envelops means it covers the entire anode wire, regardless of the position of the primary ionization or the number of primary ionizations. So this case I have drawn, this first diagram I have drawn for the case of proportional counter, and this second one is for the case of GM tube. So you can see that in the case of proportional counter, free electron approaches the anode wire from one radial direction. So the free electrons, they are reaching the anode wire from one radial direction. So there is one electron which is formed due to the primary ionization, and this electron drifts towards the anode wire, and during its journey it will cause secondary ionizations. And all these electrons which are formed in the secondary ionizations, all these electrons will be moving in this direction. So the free electrons approach the anode wire from one radial direction, and secondary ions are formed on that side of the anode wire. So the electron is moving, it is approaching the anode wire from one radial direction, and the secondary ions which are formed over here, they are formed on the one side, on that side of the anode wire only. But in the case of GM tube, you can see due to the emission of these photons, one avalanche triggers another avalanche, this avalanche triggers third avalanche, then this avalanche has triggered another avalanche in the downward direction on the downside of the anode wire, and similarly this avalanche has triggered this fifth avalanche. So there will be large number of Townsend avalanche happening, and one avalanche will trigger another avalanche, and so on. So in the case of GM tube, many avalanches are initiated at random radial positions. So you can see that this first avalanche is originated at this point. Then this avalanche initiates another avalanche at this position. This avalanche initiates the third avalanche at this position. So you can see that position of the origin of the avalanche is changing. So many avalanches are initiated at random radial positions, So the fourth avalanche is initiated over here, and this avalanche is initiated over here. So you have random radial positions at which the avalanches are initiated along the anode wire, and hence the secondary ions which are formed in this case, the secondary ions surround the whole anode wire. Secondary ions means the positive ions. So the electrons will be drifting towards the anode wire and you will have the positive ions. So the positive ions in this case will surround the whole anode wire. So there will be some positive ions due to this avalanche. There will be positive ions which are formed in this avalanche. Then there are some positive ions formed in this avalanche and so on. So the positive ions, the secondary ions in the case of GM tube surround the whole anode wire. So they are surrounding the whole anode wire. But in the case of proportional counter, the secondary ions are formed on one side, on this side of the anode wire. So this is the difference between the proportional counter and the GM tube. So in the case of GM tube, around the anode wire, secondary ionizations have increased by large factor. So if you will compare proportional counter and the GM tube, you can see that in the GM tube, secondary ionizations are far greater as compared to that of proportional counter. So around the anode wire, secondary ionizations which are made, they are increased by a large factor when you will compare these two diagrams. Now if in the case of GM tube, if this Giger discharge continues, then how do we get a pulse? In the case of proportional counter, when all these electrons are collected at the anode wire, when these electrons flow, then we get a pulse across the resistance. But in the case of GM tube, if one avalanche is triggering another avalanche, this avalanche is triggering the third avalanche and so on, if this process continues, then how do we get a pulse in the case of GM tube? Because for a pulse, the electrons, all the electrons must flow and complete the circuit. And again, when next avalanche will get formed, that avalanche will result into another second pulse. So one avalanche will lead to one pulse. Then if second avalanche occurs after these all electrons are collected, when second avalanche will occur, then we will get a second pulse. But in the case of GM tube, how do we get a pulse if this process continues forever? So if this process continues forever, we won't be able to get a single pulse. We will be getting multiple pulses for one ionizing event. For one ionization event, we will be getting multiple pulses. But in GM tube, we do get a single pulse for one particle which has entered the material. So when one particle, let's say alpha particle, enters the material, when it enters the detector, we get a single pulse in the case of GM tube. So how does this happen? Because if this Giger discharge continues forever, we will be getting electrons forever in the circuit. And how do we get a single pulse in that case? So means there is a termination of the Giger discharge in the GM tube. So there is a termination of the Giger discharge. At one point, this process stops. And when this process stops, then we get a pulse. So all these electrons get collected and after that this process gets terminated, this process stops and we get a single pulse in the electronic system which is attached with this GM tube. So how this Giger discharge phenomena gets terminated? So the basic idea behind the termination of the Giger discharge is that you can see that large number of secondary ionizations are occurring around the anode wire. Around the anode wire, there are large number of ionizations which are occurring. So these electrons which are formed, along with these electrons, we will have the corresponding positive ion. With every electron, there will be a positive ion generated inside the gas. So if large number of secondary ionizations are occurring around the anode wire, obviously there will be large number of positive ions present around the anode wire. As we have said that this anode wire is connected to the positive terminal of the external voltage and this cathode is connected to the negative terminal. So if around the anode wire large number of positive ions are present, then in the vicinity of the anode wire the electric field will decrease. So electric field will decrease due to the accumulation of the positive ions around the anode wire. So this you can imagine from the fact that let's say if you have a positive ion, if you have two positive charges, then their electric fields will repel each other. So these two charges will repel each other and the electric field lines will look something like this. So in between these two positive charges, the electric field decreases. So the same kind of thing happens over here. So this you do not have to write in your exam. This is just for your understanding that how the electric field reduces inside the GM tube. So you have to write over there is that when Giger discharge occur, when large number of secondary ionization occur around the anode wire, large number of positive ions are accumulated around the anode wire. And anode wire is already positively charged, it is connected to the positive terminal, and if large number of positive ions are collected, they are accumulated around the anode wire, then the electric field in the vicinity of the anode wire decreases. Electric field in the vicinity of the anode wire decreases because these electrons which are formed, they will easily get collected by the anode, because electrons, they are less massive as compared to the positive ions. Positive ions, they are very heavy as compared to the electrons. So they require large amount of time to move towards the cathode. So for some time, the positive ions will be accumulated around the anode wire, and with time, they will slowly move towards the cathode. So when the positive ions are accumulated around the anode wire, in that time the electric field in the vicinity of the anode wire decreases. And if the electric field decreases, we know that further avalanche cannot happen. So avalanche, Townsend avalanche can happen only if the strength of the electric field is high. And if around the anode wire strength of electric field decreases due to the accumulation of the positive ions, if the strength of the electric field decreases, there is no chance of Townsend avalanche. Further Townsend avalanche cannot happen, and hence the Giger discharge terminates. So all these electrons, they get collected at the anode wire and you get a single pulse in the electronic circuit, and the Giger discharge terminates. It comes to an end. The positive ions are created along with each electron in an avalanche. So in every avalanche, along with electrons, free electrons, positive ions are created, and mobility of the positive ions is much less than that of the free electrons, because positive ions are heavier as compared to the free electrons. So mobility of positive ions is much less, and these positive ions remain nearly motionless during the time free electrons are collected by the anode. So when the electrons which are formed in the Townsend avalanche, when all the electrons are collected by the anode, in that time the positive ions are nearly motionless because they are massive as compared to the free electrons. So slowly they will drift towards the cathode wire, they will drift towards the cathode, but during the time free electrons are collected, in that time these positive ions remain nearly motionless. So around the anode wire, concentration of these positive ions is sufficiently high. So around this anode wire, the concentration of the positive ions is sufficiently high that magnitude of the electric field reduces. So due to the accumulation of these positive ions around the anode wire, electric field in the vicinity of the anode wire decreases, and this will terminate the Giger discharge, because if electric field decreases, no further avalanche can be formed. So avalanche can be formed if the electric field is sufficiently high that one electron is further causing secondary ionizations. But if the electric field reduces in the vicinity of the anode wire, if the electric field reduces, then further avalanche cannot happen. So Giger discharge terminates at this point. For a fixed applied voltage to a GM tube, so this GM tube is given, is applied with an external voltage. For a fixed applied voltage, for a fixed applied voltage to a GM tube, Giger discharge is terminated after developing about same total positive charges regardless of number of original ion pairs created by the incident radiation. So what is the meaning of this statement? Let's say in this GM tube you have applied a fixed voltage. So for the Giger discharge to terminate, it will require the same amount of positive charges around the anode wire every time. So if fixed external voltage is applied to this GM tube, then same number of, almost same number of positive ions are required around the anode wire to terminate the Giger discharge. So let's say if one primary ionization is made at this point and another primary ionization is made at this point, then third ionization, primary ionization is made at this point directly by the ionizing radiation. So this electron will form its Townsend avalanche, and that Townsend avalanche which is formed by this electron, it will trigger another avalanche. Similarly, this electron, as it is drifting towards the anode wire, this will form its own avalanche, and this avalanche can trigger another avalanche. And similar is the case with this ionization. But for a particular GM tube, if you have applied fixed voltage to the GM tube, in that case, same amount of positive ions are required. As soon as you achieve the same number of positive ions around the anode wire, the Giger discharge will terminate and you will get a pulse in the electronic circuit which is attached. So for a fixed external voltage, you require same amount of positive charges to be accumulated no matter how many ionizations, primary ionizations are made. But the Giger discharge will terminate as soon as the same number of positive ions get collected. So it doesn't mean that if you have three primary ionizations at the initial stage, the pulse height will increase. So this is not the case in the case of GM tube. In the case of GM tube, as you have reached same number of positive ions, as same number of positive ions get accumulated around the anode wire, the Giger discharge will terminate over there. So this means that, let's say if you have only one primary ionization and in another case you have three primary ionizations. So this means that no matter how many primary ionizations are made, the pulse height will remain the same. The Giger discharge will terminate when certain number of positive ions get collected around the, they get accumulated around the anode wire. So the Giger discharge will terminate over there and you will get a pulse in the electronic circuit. So this means that all the output pulses are about the same size in the case of GM tube. So if you have alpha particle, we know that alpha particle makes more primary ionizations as compared to beta particle. But for both alpha and beta particle, the pulse height will remain the same. In the same GM tube, the pulse height will remain the same. The pulse height will be same for the alpha particle and for the beta particle. So this is the disadvantage of GM tube, that this does not differentiate, the GM tube does not differentiate between the two types of ionizing radiations, or it does not differentiate between two energies. So let's say if you have alpha particle of E1 energy and another alpha particle is of E2 energy. So let's say E1 is greater than E2. Energy of this alpha particle is greater than the energy of another alpha particle. So obviously this alpha particle will make more primary ionizations and this alpha particle will make less number of primary ionizations. But for these both alpha particles, the pulse height in the GM tube will remain the same, and the reason is that Giger discharge terminates as soon as certain number of positive ions get accumulated around the anode wire. So the pulse height will remain the same no matter how many primary ionizations are made at the initial stage. In the next lecture, we will discuss about the topic quenching.